Nina Money, Nai Nari Lester Goodnawitcha Irabinna Rigney. Ngai Amma Amma, the Professor of Education at the School of Education. Ngai Chau Yungandalia Yakunandalia Nankara Ngai Chalia. Kuriki Ngai Chalia. Kartanya Ngai Chalia. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm really honoured to be before you today. And in my, as is my cultural custom, that I have acknowledged the land on which we stand at the moment, which is the Kaurna, and which is my country. So it's nice to honour my people. I acknowledge their sovereignty. I acknowledge our sovereignty. I'd like to thank the wonderful mother who the debt owed is immense. Dr. Alice Rigney, first female Aboriginal principal in Australia. You feature in my presentation tonight. And who established amongst a tidal wave of dissent the first urban Aboriginal school, the Kaurna Plains School, which most other urban Aboriginal schools are modelled on. It's with great respect that I honour you tonight, not only as your offspring, but as what you've done for our community. My colleagues, Pro Vice-Chancellor Meredith, it's wonderful to have you at our university. The Provost is here, Professor Evans. Thank you very much for attending. My colleagues in this fine university and in my terrific school, thank you for the honour of being alongside you. One of the most important things in my journey is to give back to, I'm on the journey of giving back. I'm with you for a short period of time, that may be anywhere between 5 to 10 years. This is where I started my career. I cut my teeth on theory at the University of South Australia. And I've gone to work in some of the best universities in the world. But I've come back, and this is just as better than any of the other universities I've worked at. It is a real honour to be here tonight, and I'm going to give you an insight into two things tonight. The first is my intellectual journey and what I bring to complement the skills that you have and the university has. And then I want to chart you through why Aboriginal education matters. And I want to take you through Australian choices and what has happened over the last 3 decades. And I want to conclude, if I may, what needs to matter going forward. I want to say to you before I begin that illiteracy is poison. And that at the moment, the digital age is changing everything. And I want you to know that the digital age is changing everything. And our future, and why you should care. But before I begin, I want to tell you 3 stories, because my culture uses story, orality, text, dance, song, and has all of these beautiful ways by which it educates its young. And Indigenous parents and leaders have for a long time prioritised Aboriginal education and has asked governments to do so for the benefits of their children. And that an Indigenous future is to educate an Aboriginal child into an Aboriginal education, not out of one. And that Aboriginal education matters And the question that really gets me out of bed every night is, what skills do an Aboriginal Australian child will need to thrive in a modern 21st century? And how can we be sure that the classrooms that we're doing today are future-proofing Aboriginal communities for tomorrow? What is the 21st century of Aboriginal education, and what does that look like? And I'm going to try and answer some of these questions. But here is the three stories that I want to tell to you today. The first is on your left, my right. And I can't put up the photo of the young children in Pipalajara, where I was with my close friend Stephen Marshall, the leader of the opposition. And in Pipalajara, in the Arnongul Pitinjara Yankunanjara lands, the Pipalajara school is quite small. But we were moved into a class where there were a group of grade threes, and they were busily drawing. And there were about six or seven kids at the back who weren't really that interested in drawing, but there was this one young child at the front who was drawing as if her life depended upon it. So I went up with the translator to the young child and said, "What are you drawing?" And in Pitinjara, she then wrote back and said, "I'm drawing the radioactive monster." And I looked at the translator, and once the translator had told me of this, and I said, "Nobody knows what that looks like. So why is she drawing it?" So I said, "Nobody knows what that looks like. What do you have in your mind?" And she said, "I will show you soon as I finished." So what this child had is a whole sense of an imagination of something that doesn't exist, and was going to show me what radioactivity looked like. Now, you've got to remember, this community is only 8 hours from ground zero where the atomic bomb was tested. These kids know everything there is to know about radioactivity and how it affects Aboriginal communities. The second story is, this is still on the same first story. When the kids at Pipalajara were asked and they needed to solve a problem in the local community, this community speaks English as its third language. So the kids were posed by some serious teachers and said, "We need to get a message to your community without using words that there is unhealthy foods in our store. How are we going to do that without words? Can we do it some way? So they went on a task, and this is what they come up with. They knew that some of their communities couldn't speak English very well, so they eventually wanted to show how much sugar was in each of the products that were in the local store and was in the school canteen. And they used not one sense of text, but they got a powerful message across to their community that this stuff is killing you. Wonderful imagination. The second story I want to tell you about is that the face at the top is Dr. Chris Matthews, the first Aboriginal mathematician who's got a PhD. And he is trying to do in mathematics what I'm trying to do in literature and literacy with Aboriginal communities. And he started up the first Aboriginal Mathematics Teachers Association and is doing some terrific work with some kids. So what we have here is innovation, excellence. And then the last story I want to start with is the one to my left, to your right, as the $50 note. Now, there may be some of you may not have seen a $50 note lately with the cost of things happening at the moment, but this is David Unipin. David Unipin had 19 patents pending. He couldn't afford one of them. So lots of his inventions were hijacked and were stolen. He invented the wide-angle shearing clippers now that New Zealand has made famous. He invented the plough. He invented a perpetual motion machine. And he was a lay preacher. He was a lay academic. And he worked extensively with University of Adelaide. But he was doing this as mostly from the church that you can see on the $50 note at Raukan at Ngarangiri. So these three stories tell us about innovation, imagination, and they tell us about excellence. And that these three things, imagination, intelligence, and Aboriginal excellence, didn't arrive on a boat. Education did not arrive on a boat or a ship. It has always been here. We don't lack intelligence. Indigenous peoples lack opportunity. I want to tell you about our first, particularly in the Kaurna country, our first foray into what is, you would know as Western schools. Now, when the first missionaries came to South Australia, Teichelman and Claremore Sherman set up a school called Piltawadli, and it's at where the Adelaide Weir is on the end of Lake, on the end of Karawirapari, in my language. In your language, it's the Torrens River. So where the par 3 golf course is where the Piltawadli, the first school that taught Kaurna kids in Kaurna. That was the first school. So these German missionaries were amazing. So they taught, they didn't teach them in English. They knew that their first language was important to learn English. And you know, as well as I do as educators, that it's your first language that you hang every other culture and language on. That's where you learn this through. So Germans knew this, that English wasn't the be-all, end-all, and that we weren't multilingual, or well, monolingual. So what you see here is teachings of Kaurna kids, Pitpawi, Kartanya, and Wilji Leda here. And if you can have a look at the print writing here, all in cursive, extremely neat, and we have got these letters back now, and they're in the University of Adelaide store. And here is cursive writings by Kaurna people within the first 10 years to 20 years of the state. So this puts rest, my colleagues, friends and relatives, to the notion that of the ineducability of Indigenous peoples, and that somehow the knowledge and legitimacy of education that were here prior to colonization had no legitimacy or no science. So what we have then is two important stories that I want to tell you about the South Australian Education Act and what matters. So what matters in Australia in the early years, and the very first time that I wanted to go and see what mattered in Australia in those first early years was to go to some of the very first early educational documents of what mattered in the legislation. So in 1929, this is the 1852 legislation of South Australian Educational Act on the left-hand side. And from this, almost every single amendment of this very act has occurred. So as you know, what would have mattered back in 1852, Indigenous peoples aren't in this act. Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples aren't in this act. And the 60 or so Aboriginal languages that are in South Australia aren't in this. Indigenous knowledges that I spoke about aren't here. But the Educational Act becomes amended around 1915. And what we see here is that in around 1929, Section 53, Article 1 says that teachers should, anyone who was employed as a teacher in South Australia has to declare that they will teach in English. And if they fail to comply, Article 3 suggested that each teacher will be liable to be prosecuted of £50 each. So you were required to teach English, and if you didn't, you would be charged. You would be fined. And it's not Aboriginal people gets implemented through different sections, but it's not until late in 1972 that Indigenous matters begin to be inserted in these educational acts of what is important, what is educational legitimacy, and what matters in schools to be taught to Australian children, South Australian children. So in 1972, we see Section 16, Article 1, that says that we will include Aboriginal schools, and Aboriginal is in small, lowercase a. Yet all the way through the documents, South Australia is spelt with a capital A. So what we see here is how Indigenous peoples are written about. And this fascinated me as a young scholar because I was looking for me and my community and the Piltawadli school, the Indigenous knowledges through the three stories that I told you in each educational act. Now, I also have found that we have moved considerably and made enormous gains in Aboriginal education. But for me, as a young man growing up, this is me with my first Nurdli Gayimbara. So this is Indigenous knowledges again. So this is what I come with as a professor. So I know intimately the river literacies and the saltwater literacies of this fish. I know how it breeds, what its juvenile status looks like. And this is my mission that I grew up on. I grew up on a reserve. This arrow points to my grandmother's house, which is across an area on the mission called the Plantation. And it had a slavery name. Most of the mission had slavery names around it. And this is Narunga Street that you can see up the top here. So this is a very antiquated map, but this is this photo here is testimony to Western science. This isn't Indigenous science, because our people wouldn't have put this mission right here, because there's not enough food to sustain almost 700 population here of Narunga people that are forced onto this mission. This is Western knowledge that puts us here, not Indigenous knowledge. And so we live here on these new terms called Aborigines or Aboriginals. And no longer are we allowed to use our names of Narunga. So this fish is quite important. And as I said, if you're a teacher in our community back then, you need to know saltwater literacies, fish literacies, breeding literacies, and so on. And here I am, the one in the shorts with the cutchety, deadly, skinny legs, in these shorts with my nana. And this is this would have been the family truck or the family car. This is what a luxury sedan looks like back then. And you can see I'm getting, if you could look inside my mind here, I'm getting a whole range of Indigenous knowledges told by my elders of how to walk the country softly. So all that knowledge, Indigenous knowledges. So what you see up the top here is what we call first fire knowledges or first fire technology. So here is the one that's up the top. I wish I had a pointer, but I don't. The one that's up the top is the Kuri dance or the Palti dance, where there would have been 100 dancers up there in Kaurna country. And you will see the little group just to the left. And that is a drum. There are drum sets there. There's lots of belief that we didn't have drums. Of course we did. Angus painted them in 1847. And our community also talks about first fires and second fires. And this is first fire technology here. This is a particular time in our community of before this fire technology and after it. You'll see also fire stick farming here and three or four trees in the background. There are 11 foods that come from each of these trees. And we know the fire species of plant here that we're burning in order to do fire stick farming. This boat bark work here is not from my community, but I wanted to tell you that our communities across the entire country, Aboriginal people knew of newcomers who were dispossessed from their countries since time immemorial. This tells of Europeans arriving. And my dreaming, which is Takari's dreaming, my daughter here, and my wife also has custodian, which has been passed through my mother sitting there, and my elders from 40,000 years. So I am the inheritor of 40,000 years of Indigenous knowledges. And as a professor, I'm just trying to fix the last 200. So we have this history of people coming and going. Our Indigenous knowledges go back to a long time ago. It tells, this is Wanjina, the oldest part of Australia is the Kimberley. And so these knowledges, these literacies, these texts tells us of people who arrived here that look quite weird. But these are all carbon dated to separate years. The ones that are oldest on this page is the Bradshaws up the very top, and they look different to Wanjina of these people that came. And this is how we told our stories. And in the middle, there are more boat peoples, but they didn't come on big boats with sails. This is aged at the time when Gondwana land is splitting up. And the other section of different peoples that look different is these A and B sedules up here. These groups, these knowledges, are those in which I am custodian of 40,000 more more years. And I want to just emphasize this notion that this is Gail Ngapingari's work, Grandmother's Story. And what she's talking about here is climate change. Because three of these circles here, this is telling where women have to move. You can see that all artwork here, particularly dot works, are aerial prints of the landscape. And the yellow stick figures in here are maps to get to the areas of traditional ceremony. Now, three of these water holes are not present anymore because they have dried up. So Gail talks about this in her work as the classic architecture of climate change. So it shouldn't surprise you, my colleagues, that Indigenous peoples in Australia, in settler societies like Australia and around the world, embrace Western knowledges because of their love of Aboriginal ones. And that failing at school is a new phenomenon. I'm sure census must go, when they come to our house, must go around the twist. Because when they knock on our door, they say, how many Aboriginal people have you got here? Well, two families. How many degrees have you got? Oh, well, we've got two PhDs, one master's, six bachelor degrees. We've got the first physiotherapist is... occupational therapist, Tirupa, Trevor on the left, the first female Aboriginal principal, a lawyer, another principal at Point Pierce, my sister, the head of Aboriginal child health in South Australia is my other sister. So this puts testimony and an end to the notion of deficit. So when I was a scholar, a young scholar, I was extremely taken by education. I remember I wanted to get some money, so I was a diesel mechanic in another life, and then all of my female elders particularly said, no boy, you won't be a diesel mechanic, we need teachers. And I could see my colleague, Michael Colburn, smiling as well, because I'm sure that's happened to him. His family and his community said, we need you as an educator. So you can see my first degree was in education. My second was Master of Curriculum Leadership under a terrific University of South Australia scholar called Professor Basil Moore. And one of my closest colleagues, whose work I respect immensely, Professor Rob Haddam is in the audience as well, and I hope you're feeling better. He's in the audience, and we did some master's work together on curriculum leadership and a PhD in Aboriginal education. This is where I'm at. So the very first thing I wanted to do was to go back and look where Aboriginal education featured, and you saw that I chased policy. And it's been a passion of mine to try and change policy. So I've worked with the best, I've worked with three prime ministers to try and change Aboriginal policy. Then I had the duty of making sure I was across theory. And everything we know about children's learning stem from two particular giants in the educational field. That is, you either understood children from Freud in 1920s, or you understood them from the whole notion of Piaget's work. And what mattered here to things like Piaget was that he was suggesting that children couldn't get into abstract mode until they got into the very operational, foundational perspectives. And this was fascinating because I thought that the last stage of Piaget's theory was Aboriginal peoples were in the first. So according to Piaget, you can't form abstract formations until you are in the stage four of formative operational thinking. Whereas dreaming and chukuba is as abstract as it comes. And you get it when you're born. When you are born, you are rolled in charcoal after a fire burnt from your country, and you as a child grow up knowing that you have been bathed in a fire made from the wood from your country, and that the very first time you can take breath, abstractness is upon you. An Aboriginal matter. And Freud and Piaget didn't study Aboriginal children. And yet it is the essence of everything we know about how children learn. So I was fascinated by this, and it caused me conundrum. Because when I graduated with my educational degree, the first thing that I wanted to do was to go and see. I was fascinated by how new countries who were reborn, who have been internally fighting amongst each other, I wanted to find out how these countries reform themselves. So I thought that I could study things like new birth countries or new settler societies like South Africa, Guatemala. The newest country of all is East Timor. So what happens when the gun and the enemy are fighting each other internally, and then all of a sudden something happens, and then the next day they have to reconcile? So I ended up wanting to see what is the role of the teacher in trying to reconcile the country. Because when South Africa threw to the dustbins of history apartheid, it left reconciling the country to the classroom. So it was my experience from these understandings that the work of the classroom does the work of the nation in reconciling. So once the bullet and the ballot has passed, then comes the curriculum and the teacher. And it is the teacher's role to be able to solve reconciliation and get those that have been killing each other to reconcile through a classroom. And so what we see here is exactly what Julian Germain's work in Classroom Portraits. So here are kids in classrooms and innovation, trying to work through some of the problems of their country. But after the war has long gone, it is the sage that brings in to transform the country. And I thought that I, with this knowledge of these new birth countries, could find out how I could try and save Australia with my colleagues. Why Aboriginal education mattered, and it needs to matter for the future if this country is to survive as a country or mature as a country. And so what you see here are trauma in kids. Jermaine's work captures trauma, and they want change. And who's going to do it? Not the politician, not the lawyer. It's the sage, it's the teacher, it's you. And that's why I bring you revolutionary praise for the work that you do, either with the poor or Indigenous kids or the wealthy or the talented. What you do is really, really important, because it's us that stand in front of classes like this. It's us as teachers that get out in the middle of the night at 3 o'clock and drive past or walk past or crawl past gunfire to get to kids who need a classroom. Teachers and our colleagues without borders do an amazing job. So Jermaine's work says that children are important and are the future, and they matter, no matter what colour, what gender, what class. And their knowledges matter and their literacies matter. So I wrote a book with, co-edited a book called Gus Warby, to tell of the experience of how the settler shares space with those whom the settler colonises. I wanted to put into a book the experiences that I'd learned from South Africa with Professor Basil Moore when I was there. And I wanted to write about treaty. I want to influence the thing that I learned. What is, if it's not in the Constitution, it's not in the classroom. So if you don't have treaty, then you don't have time in the classroom. If you're not in your birth certificate of your country, which is the Australian Constitution, then you will never ever see a NAPLAN test in Aboriginal languages, or whether people are literate in their own language. So I was fascinated by these. So how do we share political, legal, cultural, educational, pedagogical space in settler societies, particularly in Australia? So I wrote about what a treaty may look like under education conditions. I wrote about what the law, how do we reconcile education? And at the moment, all we've got is the courts. And thankfully, we've got the national curriculum. I wrote about how Indigenous people's knowledges and wisdoms can be embedded in pedagogy and curriculum. And I'm more interested now than ever on how much capacity Indigenous peoples have to adapt to climate change, and whether they have that capacity. And the only infrastructure in most Aboriginal communities is either the school or the clinic. So it's the school that's going to have to do the hard work of getting Aboriginal people's capacity ready for climate change. And so I ask some really big questions in the three big questions for Aboriginal futures in two-way teaching and learning. So we've got some challenges in South Australia, and I want to, this is where, enough about me, I want to now move into where I see the future being. And for me, the future, Aboriginal futures, is built on digital excellence and STEM excellence. And I'll try and influence you with all the eloquence that I can muster around why STEM is so important for Indigenous peoples to be ready for climate change. So here is Tony Vincent's work. And Tony Vincent's work, when it first came out in 2007, was largely ignored. It prophesied with hard science where the disadvantaged communities would be in 5 years, and ask governments to fund those schools where the red areas of his maps were going to be. And you could look at every strategic plan in 2009 and 2010 across this state and territories in this country that just totally ignored the science. So at the moment, his new iteration of 2015 work is highlighting the areas that are under excruciating and torturous rhythm of disadvantage. And that black and white that live in these areas shouldn't tolerate that type of human condition. And that we have no justification in this state at all to spend monies on subs whilst we have substandard financial funding for schools that desperately need them. All schools aren't equal and they're not funded equally. So when I sat in those debates around how we should model and formulate Gonski, and then it went out the window as soon as the Liberal government came in, it was excruciatingly frustrating. So here he prophesies again, and I look forward to seeing whether our state will rebound. These are some of the areas that you know of colleagues that teach in them that need urgent assistance. How to live together in these communities. Some of these communities aren't just Indigenous. They have refugees and immigrants within them because of the detention centres of where they're placed. And again, my colleague, Professor Haddam, is running a forum this year, later this year, on how we live together, how schools promote living together, the very essence that I've been chasing in my undergraduate degree. And we're trying to get people into a forum to discuss how we get schools to do the work of the nation again around inclusion. He's saying, Tony Vincent, to us loudly, the dominant characteristics of South Australia's multiple disadvantages locations are based on unemployment, poor educational levels, long-term unemployment, criminal convictions as young adults that are disengaged. And the one that he's just missed out on being a blue here is the lack of access to digital technologies or the internet. So why will Indigenous education matter? Well, it matters because of the population statistics. Here in the blue, almost 60% of the Indigenous population are under the age of 21. Only 3% of the Indigenous population are over the age of 60. These statistics mimic war-torn societies and the third world. When you invade a country or you are at the end of a gun, the most thing that you want to do is to remove the adults. And this legacy happens everywhere, and it's scientifically proven that this is the way that you colonise. Indigenous children don't live out there, they live amongst you. They either live in the city or they live just on the outskirts in country regional areas. Only 25% Indigenous peoples live out there. And there's only 140,000 Indigenous students in schools. Tony Abbott, or I should say, Minister Pine, should know every one of them by name because they're so small. The population is so small, but how do we get this so wrong? This is why we need to understand that the youth population are getting robust in accepting that school failure and higher education failure is acceptable, and it's not acceptable. This is what critical theorists called hegemony, that the rite of passage through school is somehow failure. And a famous theorist, critical theorist, which you know and I do, Giroux, talks about this. Edward Said talks about Orientalism, how the Orient embraces the views of itself written by others. Indigenous children of this level deserve an Indigenous teacher. And at the moment in Australia, thanks to the good work of Macedi and Professor Buskin, who's at this university, have come up with a workforce plan that there are only 4,000 teachers in Australia, 0.7% of the total teaching population. We are not even 1% yet. Aboriginal kids and non-Aboriginal kids deserve Aboriginal principals like the one you've got here, the first female Aboriginal principal. And I'm the only Aboriginal staff member of our school, and I'm so honoured to be there. But I can't wait for the next one to come. I can't wait to mentor Aboriginal PhDs in this university. I'm excited, and I thirst for that. So here's some of the challenges that we have, but I'm glad to say that we're on the cusp of some technologies that can solve the tyranny of distance. So here are the Aboriginal populations done by a terrific demographer, Taylor. And Taylor, I believe, is second to Graham Hugo, but Taylor's work is amazing. And here you have Indigenous peoples, and here's the distances they're travelling for basic services. And as fast as the NBN can roll out, we think that we can solve some of these issues about when of putting services online and educating Indigenous groups to be able to access those services. Does anybody here use MyGov? Hands up. MyGov is the one site that all schools should be linked to because it's the one-stop shop for everything you need for your social services, for your benefits, for your anything that you have to access from governments. And yet schools' websites aren't attached to MyGov. So we are trying to wheel MyGov out to Indigenous communities as fast as we can. We also have some challenges. One of the things I also want to make here is some hope for Indigenous peoples in the audience. And that is the national curriculum, when mum and bubs in this area here who have dialysis in these Western Australian clinics were travelling as far to Alice Springs to get dialysis. So when mum takes bubs across the border, we're hoping that the Australian curriculum will be able to insert bubs in the Northern Territory system and eventually be able to teach exactly and take off from where they have left from their other state. We think that the National Broadband Network will bring us some relief in accessing these services, but also being able for Aboriginal peoples to communicate across Skype and so on. But we also have those that don't think that Aboriginal education matters, or that Indigenous knowledges, that beautiful three knowledges that I spoke about, Aboriginal languages, Aboriginal English, and non-Indigenous English and non-Indigenous knowledges, all which Aboriginal kids richly bring to the school. There are some amongst us that say that Aboriginal education doesn't matter, that the goal is to educate Aboriginal kids out of an Aboriginal education. And so I'm glad this is taped, and I'm hope that Gary Johns will watch this. Because him and I have been sparring in the media right back since 1992. Now, this is a very influential research centre, Menzies Research Centre. It advised John Howard on his 10-point plan and so on. So this is a very influential person. So his basic belief that he's suggesting to teachers that if Aboriginal languages are present in your classroom, they inhibit the learning of English. And this is the reason why, according to Johns, you've got NAPLAN tests so low.
So his hypothesis needs to be rebuffed. And at that stage in 2006, there were some colleagues in the audience that were writing some really terrific stuff. My colleague Alan Reid, who at that time was doing an amazing task around trying to rebuke some of these areas. You'll know full well, my colleagues, of this rebuke. And that is that somehow the cross-curriculum priorities in Australian curriculum, what matters now, should be synthesizing those knowledges on the fringe of the Australian curriculum. And I hope this is taped so Kevin can see this. It's that simply Asian knowledges, Indigenous knowledges, don't fit. And that somehow the national curriculum is bloated, and the first thing that should go out of them is those knowledges that have been here for 40,000 years. So the sickness, the bloated notion of a national curriculum, the way that you cure it is dispensing with the oldest knowledge of the country and those who bring that knowledge to school. So what matters here in some views are quite telling of the barometer of this country at the moment, your country. I want to also just focus quickly on the barometer of what matters. The Northern Territory intervention was the first, or was the second intervention that changed the Racial Discrimination Act. So the federal government said that we are going to override the Racial Discrimination Act to give you more by taking away your rights. And when the Northern Territory intervention came out, it came out under the guise of education to protect women and children and to increase Aboriginal attendance at school. And yet, the evidence suggested that not in the education name can you argue for Northern Territory intervention, and that the scientific data suggested that this made no improvement by forcing Aboriginal children into schools. It's what's in the schools and how it's done. By pushing a kid and forcing them to sit on a chair at school doesn't change their quality of education. The closure of bilingual education, Gonski, the Indigenous Advancement Strategy that's funded only five STEM, Indigenous science, technology, engineering and maths, only five projects out of the 250 projects that it's did. The closure at the moment of 150 Aboriginal communities in Western Australia, and a third of those communities have a school and a medical clinic that's the part of their core infrastructure. So a third of those schools will be closed if the Barnett government proceeds. Mental illness and youth suicide should be a part of the COAG agenda for closing the gap, and it's not. Adam Goods, how do we read Adam Goods at the moment in the barometer of what matters in this country? And the 2015, since 7 years it's been implemented, not substantial improvement have we seen. And if the mainstream kids in NAPLAN aren't getting it right, you can be sure that refugees and Indigenous Australians are finding it tough. So what has been mattering for Indigenous peoples? What have been some successes where what mattered really made a difference? Well, in 1960 to 2000s, Indigenising school was a priority, and we have got some great gains in Aboriginal linguists, Aboriginal land rights. We've got lawyers, we've got anthropologists, we've got medicine doctors, we've got health practitioners, nurses, doctors. We achieved the target of growing 1,000 Aboriginal teachers by 1990. We achieved that twofold. And education, humanities, arts, social sciences, health sciences and professions made a terrific contribution to the human condition of Aboriginal peoples. But we need the same investment into what I'm suggesting are the wicked problems that face Indigenous peoples going forward. And that the priority, what matters going forward from here, are also those momentum changes we've got. But we now need to invest equally into the future of Aboriginal children by focusing on STEM. Because the wicked problems are before Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples. Biodiversity loss, carbon, renewable energies, water, how we can make sure that there is food security for Aboriginal people. If the sea level rises by 0.9 of a metre, that it's supposed to, then my community, in 100 years, then my community will have 30 centimetres on the 26 houses on my mission of Point Pierce. And there's a cemetery also that will be underwater, where all of our old people are buried. Our school haven't even thought about how we build our community's capacity to deal with that. The Torres Strait Islanders, my colleague Stephen, the head of school, the dean, one of the classic things here with the Torres Strait Island, if the climate change is to be realised of 0.9 of a metre, that means there's 250 islands in the Torres Strait, and at least 60 of them will be underwater. So I need to grow at this university the first Torres Strait Islander engineer so that we can build some seawalls for communities to be ready. So science, math, computer science, engineering, and these professions are going to be really, really important for generations to come and the new digital economies that will come with them. So what is the innovation in concluding? What are the innovation to improve the Aboriginal condition? So this is where I'm trying to focus my energy in my research in the last 12 months, is that what innovation would most improve Indigenous futures and overcome the underrepresentation of Indigenous peoples in STEM? Well, I'm suggesting that the innovation that is upon us is inexpensive online apps, video, mobile phones, MOOCs, libraries, and services that are all interconnected by digital. And I'm suggesting that if we take these into our classrooms with a notion of this amazing innovation, that it will allow great teachers to reach millions and give students access to some of the best teachers no matter where they live, and allow learning communities to form on a global scale. And they can do this, and our schools can do this at a minimal cost. The next step is how to best support and legitimate models of Indigenous education and STEM with digital technologies into communities that haven't had them. So working with smaller budgets, educational institution will use digital technologies to collaborate. It's not the panacea, but if Indigenous communities don't yet have the click and drag literacy, then it will be well behind the formal literacy. Working with smaller budgets gives us technology shifts that allow teacher-centered learning and student-centered learning. For me, increasing effective adaptive software makes it possible for students to receive individual content delivered in game-like or conference formats or cultural formats relevant to their learning. And my colleague Barbara Spears here and her terrific work on cyber safety is something I respect immensely and looking forward to working with. So the Australian Chief Scientist, my previous Vice Chancellor, Ian Chubb, has suggested that 75% of the fastest growing occupations will require STEM. And it's interesting, in 2010 in the US, 7.6 million STEM workers had higher wages. And that the new economies, if Australia is going to be ready, it's going to have to invest in STEM. We are the only OECD country that doesn't have a STEM strategy. And if Australia is moving in this direction of STEM, then Indigenous peoples have to be inbuilt within it and not a side option. So what are some of the heavy lifters that I've come across in STEM? Well, the Macedi Project Growing More Teachers, UniSA. The Aboriginal Science School Excellence in Technology and Science is at Flinders University, but the two ambassadors is Professor Buskin and Professor Rigney, UniSA. The National Indigenous Engineering Summit at University of Melbourne. AIM ITAS, UniSA. Make It Count, Maths Excellence, UMI Deadly, Indigenous Mathematics Alliance, UniSA. Australian Curriculum is also doing some heavy lifting where Indigenous perspectives can be included in maths and science. ATSIL, the teacher standards now require all teachers to have Indigenous perspective, an Indigenous understanding before they graduate. We now have awards for Aboriginal maths and science, and we've got Indigenous digital excellence. So the wicked problems are upon us. So what are some of the obstacles in this way? There are 8% of university entrance students into universities in STEM. There are 8% of students that go into university who are Aboriginal into STEM subjects compared to 22%. So Indigenous peoples are underrepresented in STEM. So this is the problem that I have stuck up on my wall in my office, because I'm a believer that all problems have a use-by date, and I will fix this problem, hopefully. We've got to be able to look at this notion that since 2001, lots of Indigenous peoples have been enrolling in teacher, health, education, creative arts, natural and physical sciences, and very few of them have been enrolling in the STEM subjects at university. And this is happening at University of South Australia. We've got a large mass of our students very much in the health, the humanities, social sciences, but we have very few in the other areas. Why? Is because universities are having to do the work of schools. And our senior college here, our university college, is being able, and Dakia, are trying to fix a tidal wave of inefficiencies that has come with a child that's come to us from school. The further you live out of the cities, the less chance you're going to read or write. You know that. And if you look at the school achievement rates, you've got Indigenous reading, 29 out of 30 in an OECD reading, and maths, here's the other challenge that matters to us, is that Indigenous maths, there are 29 in Australia, are 29 out of 30 better only than Turkey and Mexico. So I wanted to go then and try and put my words where my mouth was, my scientific intellect to where my thoughts were. So I worked with a project called the Community-Based Adaption to Climate Change, and I wanted to see whether, with my colleagues, whether Aboriginal communities were ready to adapt. Could they adapt? Had they got the ability and the capacity to? And what we found in this research is I thought, my view is that the schools do the work of the nation, and therefore the schools in these communities would have to build capacity in amongst the community in order for it to adapt to climate change. That was my hypothesis. So, what we found was Aboriginal peoples have always adapted to climate change. We were here when the dinosaurs were here. So we know what happens when sea level rises and fresh water falls. So, the reason why Aboriginal peoples were most vulnerable to climate change is because they suffer multiple sources of disadvantage. I'll give you an example. The reason why we have to prepare Aboriginal kids urgently is because roughly 90% of the Northern Territory coast is managed by Aboriginal people. You've also got Aboriginal people living on the coastlines, in the interior. There are four types of Aboriginal people: the freshwater, the saltwater, the tropics, and the desert. And all of those will be affected if the freshwater falls or the sea level rises. So one of the things we came up with was one of our findings were that ICT potentially could strengthen the adaptive capacity in the face of climate change. I'll give you an example, emergency. So some of these communities have no way of communicating in an emergency. So if a tidal wave, heaven forbid, were to hit regions in the Torres Strait, communication would be devastated. So ICT gives the potential for a community to adapt. Safety, monitoring of their climate, mobility, speaking with scientists all around the world via Skype, gives us the ability to do this. The other thing that I've been working on with my colleagues is trying to improve maths, and this is Professor Haddam and I are working with the maths project of Peter Buskin and Will Moroney of the Australian Maths Teachers Association. And we're trying to build STEM. We wanted to see where the best practices in the country and across the world, and we want to make an improvement. The other is this work that I've done in 2013, which was looking where Telstra Foundation, this is a Cat 3, where Telstra Foundation wanted to find out where the greatest digital divide was across Australia. So where are the digital ghettos for Indigenous peoples? And I'm not going to go through that, but if you're wanting the free copy of the human report, there it is. Out of that research, Telstra Foundation donated $5 million and took up the idea, the challenge we gave it, to promote Indigenous digital excellence. So my research coined that phrase. The Telstra Foundation took it up and funded $5 million within the Indigenous Centres of Excellence in Redfern in Sydney. They've got four projects going: Community of Excellence, Indigenous Digital X Hub, and the Start Lab is their strategy. And they want to connect, this is the 30 best nerds in the country that want to connect with the best schools in the country with high Aboriginal population. These, if you are on Twitter, Indigenous X is where you'll find these 30 amazing talent. And there are digital ICT definitions of what Indigenous excellence should be, but here's how our project and the National Centre of Indigenous Excellence define digital excellence. Because others say you're either digital natives or you are digital immigrants. We refuse to use those terms because they're loaded. We would rather use that Indigenous digital excellence is what happens when Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples leverage digital technologies to increase their own and their community's well-being. You know the benefits of STEM and digital skills. We have evidence and science across the world to say that it lowers your cost, it gives you better access to health, education, jobs. Aboriginal peoples become reliant on them. They give you help in emergency. They maintain contact with family and friends. They connect you through the digital economies, and therefore Indigenous peoples see that ICT matters to them. In 2006, this is where we found our findings across the country of where the digital divide was. The further you are out, the more digital excluded you are. But have a look where non-Indigenous peoples, the green, they're almost all connected and the cable is at the door. So you see Indigenous peoples here in, this is Professor Radol's work and from the census, 2006, but have a look in 2011, how fast Indigenous peoples are taking up ICT. Just go back again. I haven't juxtaposed both of them on top of each other. Look at the very remote. I mean, Ian, this is good for you. and then look how fast they're coming onto line. So we can use this in schools and make sure that we include Indigenous peoples in the new digital revolutions. So what we've got at the moment is, was that we concluded that we've got the biggest Indigenous mass migration to the internet in history, but we know little about their digital behaviours offline or online. So what does this mean for schools? I'll tell you what it means. All of the absentees are linked for the first time in history. So how do we use that? So, you know, you can Facebook them and say, where are you? Or you can get Auntie Alice, an elder, to write to them and say, Takari Rigney, where are you? Why aren't you at school? Send. So we've got to be able to use those types of technologies. I've made an assumption in this research that if you were illiterate in English, you couldn't operate a mobile phone. How many agree with that proposition? None. Of course you can. What are Indigenous peoples connected to? I made an assumption that they are on broadband. Wrong. In 2011, Indigenous communities are connected to the fastest speed broadband in some areas. In South Australia, it's interesting. In South Australia is exactly what we found in Western Australia. And if you have a look at the very remote, the next digital divide or digital exclusion happens in outer regional. So it's just in the country regions. Whereas if you look at New South Wales, where the most Aboriginal peoples in this country live, it's pretty much, if you live the further out from Sydney, you don't have access to the internet. So Tanangere Council taught us lots of things in this research. It says, this is pretty much what's happening across the country, that the mobile is king, but you can't do homework on a mobile. And that internet they're using is basically for social stuff. And they want online stuff and they want it fast. I don't know if you saw the Game of Thrones, 1 million people downloaded it illegally. And they're suggesting 500,000 did it unconsciously. Imagine if that happened in Indigenous communities where they're the poorest of poor and only eat one meal every 48 hours. They want it just like non-Indigenous peoples. They want it fast and they want it free. And the Centrelink mobile users in Aboriginal communities spend 13.5% of their income on a digital prepaid. There's lots of cyberbullying, sexting and trolling, and we don't know how much, and that's why I'm keen to work with Dr. Spears. There's the three strikes out policy. I'm going to go and I'm going to finish. So we need to do things differently. And future-proofing Australia's workforce, the PwC smart move talked about that digital is disrupting everything and that 500 million jobs will be lost. And these are the likely jobs that will be lost. And there'll be 126,000 new jobs that will come on board and that Australia needs to be ready for them. And here's the new jobs required within the next 20 years. And these all relate to Indigenous communities, natural and physical sciences and so on. Leading businesses are getting into STEM and Indigenous peoples need to get on board because it matters. 22 million BHP with girls' maths, computer giant Cisco, 31 million. So I want to finish then by suggesting my final slide, and that is that if a digital revolution is to take place and STEM revolution to take place, we need a pedagogical and curriculum revolution. And that if a digital educational revolution is happening, then Indigenous peoples can't afford to lose that fight. So I'm working on what I'm calling the 10 big questions for a modern Aboriginal curriculum. And I'm not starting that Captain Cook arrived in Australia. That stuff can still go on. I'm not starting that John Howard refused to get with reconciliation. I'm asking 10 big questions. How did Aboriginal cultures begin? How does the earth work? What is life? What is culture and language? How are Aboriginal cultures evolving on the earth? How do we unravel the causes of Aboriginal diseases? Why does climate change from an Aboriginal view? How can we feed the world sustainably? How can we reduce our reliance on governments? How will we conserve Aboriginal diversity? And where will the science and digital revolution take us? I say this on the basis that I believe that STEM is our future. And I believe that Indigenous peoples matter. And I believe that their futures are worth writing about. Thank you.